So I did my PhD in soft matter physics, and now I work in the biochemistry lab in ESPCI, so just to say that this can happen. So the session today is about dynamical systems, and what I'm going to present is also very different from what you have seen just before, because where I realize I'm not a physicist anymore, there is no force, there is no space in what I do. So I hope you will not be too disappointed. But the question is very exciting. So you see the title, From Chemistry to Evolution. So it's a question of the origins of life, basically. And so I'm going to give also some background on this question and how you could try to have some actual quantitative and experimental approaches. So this kind of starts with a very famous quote of Darwin, of the Warm Little Pond. So he wrote in a letter to Hooker, a botanist, "And if, but if, and oh, what a big if, we could conceive in some warm little pond with all sorts of ammonia and phosphoric salts, light, heat, electricity, etc., present that a protein compound was chemically formed, ready to undergo still more changes." So all the questions, so you have the question of chemistry there, all those things, how they form complex molecules, and there is a question of dynamics, ready to undergo still more changes, and a lot of struggle is there. The type of question we try to address in the lab is about the last part, so the dynamics, and you can kind of disconnect it from the first part, what is a specific chemistry, and that's where the title of my talk comes from. Because it's very challenging to solve both at the same time. And we don't know the general principles that could lead the chemistry to finally, ultimately become an evolving system. So I'm going to show very simple models to illustrate this. But so origins of life is a big succession of problems, which you could call paradoxes. So you always have these pictures of chicken and eggs and all along. And when you solve the chicken and egg problem, you have another one and so on. Maybe this has an end, but we have not found it. So the first problem is, so I'm going to talk about molecules a little bit. When the molecular implementation of life started to be understood, so 1953, the structure of DNA, the structure of heredity, proteins and enzymes were known to be made of proteins. DNA was known to be the support of information. RNA was known, but it was not really known what it was doing. And so in his book, The Genetic Code, so Wuze, so it's in 1967, he explicitly wrote this hypothesis that in between the catalyst, the proteins, and the code, DNA, there could be something that could do both. And actually, the messenger RNA would be in between, but it was not clear whether this type of molecules could do catalytic activities. And so it was only in the 80s that it was found that RNA could be catalytic. So a catalytic RNA is called a ribozyme. So this is the hypothesis of the RNA world that was kind of going a bit further, that at the beginning you didn't have RNA, you didn't have protein, but you had organisms that would mostly rely on RNA. So because RNA can do both, can act as a support of information, but also as a catalyst. And that hypothesis has been reinforced in the latest years, notably because when we had structure of the ribosome, so I just remind you that the ribosome is a machinery which does translation, so it converts the messenger RNA into proteins, is a ribosome. So it's essentially made of RNA, and those crystallographic structure with a resolution between 3 and 5 angstrom allow to demonstrate that all the catalytic activities of the ribosome were actually due to the very big RNA scaffold that makes it. So conceptually, if you think about that, you have the ribosomal RNA that take messenger RNA and tRNAs to make proteins. So it feels like the RNA world has made, if you think by continuity, the protein world. So typically we work in this frame of the RNA world hypothesis. So this is very molecular, but I think it's necessary to know this. This is the main hypothesis about origins. Maybe this is one chicken and egg that has been resolved. So we go to the number two. Just after the book of the genetic code, actually. So there is the Eigen, so who is a chemist interested in a dynamical system. He proposed this what is called now the error threshold, or the Eigen's paradox. So I'm going to do a very small calculation to show this. So the idea is that you have a dynamical process of self-reproduction. So you have a self-reproduction organism or virus. And obviously, it can make errors from time to time. So the scheme is that you have this molecule that makes itself. And sometimes, it makes another molecule, which we tend to call a parasite. Why? So I'm going typically to call this ribozyme, and this a parasite. And you consider certain rates. So there is a self-replication rate, which I call alpha for the ribozyme, gamma for the parasite, and a certain mutation rate, mu. So the simplest way to write an equation from this is a first order equation. You say I need some m to make some m. Sometimes m becomes y, and I need some y to make some y because.
What do you mean by prosite? Parasite.
Yeah. So the idea is that this molecule is functional. And this one is just an error, and he is just using the activities of other molecules to survive. So you have a quite simple first order model. And typically, what you have to do is, at this stage, I'm going to discuss the protocol, because if you do that in a bulk, yeah.
But so in this setup, Y is also self-reproducing.
Yes, so it serves as its own template.
So then in what sense is it different from M?
So yeah, in this framework, it is not different from M. So indeed. This model is not complete chemically if you really discuss the problem of the replicase. So it is the model that Eigen has written. Because otherwise, you would have to write the kinetics also of the enzyme. So he was just thinking about a model in which actually the fact that M is necessary is discussed a posteriori. So I'm going to show how. Basically, the system collapses when there is no more M. It's more a boundary condition than something within the kinetic equation, indeed. This will grow exponentially. This is not physically possible. So in the article, and in general, in this type of model, you have to introduce a certain dilution rate, which is common, to everyone. So the typical way people do it is a form of chemostat where you imagine you have the chemical reaction and you have a certain flux, influx and outflux of matter. And there you have the chemical reaction. Actually, this is not very important in the end. I'm doing it for you because if one day you read the article, it looks very confusing if you don't know this. So the you could compute a condition on a row, on row by setting the total concentration or the total number to be constant. And so you just add these two equations, and this gives you a certain condition. Basically. But then is the idea that you measure what is there and you do a feedback on the concentration, which is not generally very, very realistic. Maybe cells do it. You have another type of model which is much simpler, which is to say that this sensing is happening in a form of compartment of cell. And then you have growth, so you have a certain volume. And then if you set the total concentration to be constant, you could say that the volume is proportional to the total number of molecules. And you are going to write a very elementary equation, which is if X is either M or Y, the concentration equation is this, which is equal to this, which is a certain production rate. And this, so V dot over V, is a growth rate of the cell. So in the context where you describe a minimal cell with self-reproducing objects, that's the condition you have. So that was a parenthesis, because rho has no impact on the following. Okay, now the question is, in which condition does the interesting molecule M survives in the presence of the parasite Y? So we can look, I have to do a very little mathematics here. You look at a first order system where I have a vector X and a matrix. So this is what the system is. This is a very elementary dynamical system, which represents this. So typically, you will have X of T equals the exponential of the matrix M times the initial condition. So for some of you, it's very trivial, but I do it explicitly. So let's say you can diagonalize your matrix. Well, I set a 2x2 matrix. The exponential of this, if I compute now this equation, I will have that x of t. So this is the eigenvector associated to the largest eigenvalue, lambda 1. This is the eigenvector associated to the largest eigenvalue, lambda 2. I multiply this matrix by x0. This gives me a certain vector y, but it doesn't matter what it is. I have then exponential of lambda 1 t and you will see that if you do the calculation, it's a sum of terms that grow exponentially with this mode and terms that grow exponentially with this mode. And as lambda 1 is higher than lambda 2, this mode disappears. So in any case, in the end, your system behaves like the eigenvector associated with the largest value multiplied by exponential growth driven by the largest eigenvalue. It is true in general, so it's that when you have a larger system, so all what I say is true in general with n variables. So you can so there is a Perron Frobenius theorem that says that you always end up with this mode winning. Okay, so after this parenthesis, now the problem is very simple. So when does M survive? I'm going to kill this. Just so my matrix M here would be this alpha minus mu gamma zero. It's a lower diagonal matrix, so the eigenvalues are the same as the things you see on the diagonal. So M survives is equivalent to very simply. So we are almost at the end of eigen demonstration. Now we would like to translate this into an interpretation at the molecular level of errors during copy. So let's say L is the length of the molecule, and epsilon is the error rate per nucleotide during the copy. So instead of writing alpha minus mu, if you talk in terms of error rate, you would like to write something like this, where this is the error rate per copy of the full molecule. And no, this is the fidelity rate actually. It's 1 minus the error rate. And so this fidelity rate is the probability to not mess L times the copy. So it is this value. Okay, so I just have to input this there. So I read it like this. This is approximate. So I take the log. And now, if I take it the other way around, I approximated this by, because the error rate is small, I obtain this. So this is a famous formula of eigen for the error threshold, which has been obtained in the general case, but as I told you, it does not matter too much. Everything I said is still true. And here you have the length of the molecule. Here you have the error rate. And here you have the selectivity. So it's how better is your initial molecule compared to its mutants. So this was then interpreted, for example, in different contexts. So in the context of viruses, people say, OK, if the size of the genome is 10 to the 4 nucleotides, and the mutants of the virus are approximately the same of the virus itself, then you have a polymerase that has an error rate, which is actually similar because the product epsilon L is approximately equal to 1. So in this context, you have replication, but you also have other parameters in the fitness. Because surviving is not, for a virus, is not just replicating, but it's also its ability to infect other cells and so on. So this is one context where you can interpret this error threshold. Now, this has been extrapolated to the problem of origins of life. And you can see it as a paradox, because there is another link, which is if you want a polymerase that does not make too many errors, it has to be a pretty elaborate molecule. So L has to be of a certain size. So it has to be long enough. But this says that it cannot be long enough. So it says that there is kind of a critical size. You cannot start evolution gradually from poor polymerases that would appear. You must directly jump to a molecule that is elaborate enough to have this small enough, but then this is long enough. So this is the origins of life interpretation. Now, the problem in reality is much, much worse than this. Because in the origins of life, the only factor to fitness in this frame is just self-replication. There is no other activity. And the mutants tend to be shorter. So experimentally, that's what you see. The error, the polymerase is going to make a new molecule and is going to skip a part of it. If I have time, I will show you the experiments. This was demonstrated in 1965 by Spiegelman. So it's the classic experiment which is associated with this problem. It's the first in vitro evolution experiment, actually. The problem is that this is always smaller than one, so there is no way life could start from a replicase alone. So you need to invoke another principle. Where is that? So what has been proposed theoretically is an article, I think, from 1997. So it's called the stochastic corrector model. So the idea is that you have, like in the case of viruses, you have other factors to fitness that could help to maintain the self-replicating molecule. And this is introduced through the idea that you have another level of selection. So you have a certain number of molecules. And then you have to imagine that those compartments, they divide. And the idea is very simple, is that there is another force of selection, and compartments which only contain parasites, they are removed from the pool, so that those things can grow again, maybe make some mistakes, but at some point, you go back and you divide and you purge your molecular population from those parasites. So there is a third chicken and egg here, which is you cannot start evolution without having this dynamics, but this dynamics requires a pretty elaborate dynamics of compartments where you need actually to grow and divide them in a certain way. So how could you have an elaborate control of the cell cycle if there is no evolution in the first place? So I must say that the initial idea, so We were collaborating with Jörg Szatmári, was to test this model, but actually it occurred to be too difficult to do experimentally. So the idea was, well, can we do something simpler? And that's good for origins of life, because the simpler you do things, the more plausible they are. So the idea was to move to the idea of transient compartments. So this idea is reminiscent of theories in genetics of Wilson group trait models, where you have phases where the objects are packed together into a compartment and submitted to selection, and then they are all pooled in a bulk. So you don't have anymore a cell cycle, you just have phases where objects are compartmentalized for some time. And there, the hope is that the system can work even when this condition is not respected. I'm going to draw the life cycle of objects under this type of protocol. Sorry. So you first have a pool, a certain number of objects. They are all in the ocean or something. And at some point, you compartmentalize them randomly. And then you incubate them so that all this processes of self-reproduction is going to occur. And then you select them. And then you pull them again. So this is compartmentalization. And it has a certain parameter, lambda, which is it's a random encapsulation, so you have a Poisson distribution about how you encapsulate the objects. And then, so I'm going to detail this after. So let's call x the fraction of interesting molecules over the total. So typically, I'm going to use sometimes n, which is just the sum of m and y. After, so you have this, then this compartmentalization. Then you have incubation during a certain time t. And then for each compartment, which has a certain initial condition n on m, I have a x bar, which is a function of n on m, and actually lambda on t. And then I do selection. So there is a certain selection function which depends on the composition of the compartment. So x is a fraction of useful molecule after the incubation. So it's m over m. M bar over M bar plus Y bar. And it goes, of course, between 0 and 1. And the more I have useful molecule, I just need an increasing function. So in the end, we will see the power of doing this kind of thing is that basically, you could choose any function. It doesn't matter too much. So your selection protocol, we will see, is not very sensitive to a lot of things. Yeah, of course.
So in this model, it's sort of important that you're imagining that M is responsible for making some apparatus that is actually making the reproduction possible.
Yes.
And Y is sort of hitching a ride on this apparatus, right?
Yes.
That's why you call it a parasite.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yes. Okay. Yeah. It's a very interesting question. So yeah, this model is against evolution somehow. We will see. So there are regimes. Well, this is more at the end, but I can say it now. There are regimes of coexistence between M and Y, and which we see in the experiment, where you can propagate Y, the initially useless molecule, across generations. And so this is, then you have kind of a space of for opportunistic new function that could evolve. So that this is a big difference between the bulk experiments as the initial eigen model, where there are two states, or there is the best, the useful molecule that reproduces and the other does not exist, or completely the opposite, you kill the system, and then there is no evolution. So when you have these compartments, there now exist regimes where you maintain both M and Y together. Yes, so the first step is compartmentalization. Which is basically random, well, which we assume to be random, according to a certain law. So you have a Poisson law. So lambda is the average number of molecules you put in the compartments at the beginning of each cycle. And statistics is telling you that you have a distribution, which is a Poisson distribution. And then you have another component in this law, is you randomly encapsulate either M or N. So you have a binomial law. That should not make mistake. So I call it X. X is a fraction of useful molecule. So this is the equation for the compartmentalization. Now there is the incubation. So it's the same equation as before, and the solution for M is very simple because it's just M dot equals M something. So you have the loss, you have a certain growth rate alpha, but you have the loss due to mutation, which is mu. And during the time t, you accumulate m bar of these objects. Now you can re-inject this in the equation for y by the method of the variation of the constant. And I cannot do this in my head, but it's pretty straightforward. And so we just have to compute this because we know everything. Okay, and as I told you, there is this selection function which I don't need to define very much. So in the end, we have three important parameters. The big lambda, the small lambda, which is the encapsulation rate, and delta, which takes into account the competition between molecules and the error rate. So big lambda, it is basically the strength of the competition between the molecules, because it is simply rewritten as this. And let's say I fix delta. Oh, so I fix a certain error rate. Now the question is there a domain in this diagram where life could start? So where I can maintain my molecule M. So we know that big lambda, if you push it to infinity, it's like a bulk. So you recover the limit, at least you know it is zero here, if you have a frontier of a domain. So the question is to know whether, so this must be a vaguely decreasing function. So is it completely flat? So does a good regime exist or not? Or is it not flat? Well, here is more the log of lambda. So you can compute it numerically, but just for the understanding, and you find that there is indeed a regime, we can quite easily determine the value for very low small lambda. So what is the strategy there? In the protocol, we have X, which is the composition at a certain stage, and we consider X prime, right, which is the composition once you have done one cycle of the protocol. And so there is a certain relation between those two things. And it's a numerical suite. And so you know that 0, so if you look at the iteration of x over time, here you would have a stable fixed point, but 0 here would be an unstable fixed point. Why? Because dx prime over, well, dx is actually larger than 1. So what we want is to evaluate this condition at x equals 0, very simply. And we have everything to do this.
Sorry.
Yes?
This does not depend on your selection
function. It does. Yeah, it does. I'm just going to show it. It just depends on the behavior of selection function at x equals 0 and x equals 1. But I'm talking about the qualitative behavior, of course. Of course, the borders of the diagram in the end are sensitive, but little sensitive, actually, to the exact shape. Okay, we solve this problem, and we want to know where the border is, so which is just deriving this. So this is a definition of where the border is at x equals 0. Well, that can be computed directly, okay, which is the good thing. So what I have not shown is a formula to integrate everything together. So I'm going to write it now in general and then apply it to this particular limit. So x prime now is basically the average of x bar over all the conditions of encapsulation. So it's n, m, and lambda. So empty compartments do not matter. So I have x bar. There it depends on f, because I do keep only proportionality to the selection function. And this is an average, so I normalize by the situation, by the distribution. So in the case lambda is very small, the point is that you just have, you mostly have two possibilities. Either the compartment is empty, or you have three. So you have empty compartments. Which do not matter. You have compartments with 1m or with 1y. So it's not very hard to evaluate this. So the distribution P lambda of 1 and 0, so this is n and m, and then I just need, so I have this, I have this, I need this, so I can just reuse this formula. This is again n and m, which is basically zero. If I don't start with any m, I cannot create m. And this formula with n equals m equals 1 gives you this. Okay, I'm almost done. So now I do compute this function, this at x equals 0. And basically what you find is this. No, this is this function. And now I evaluate it at x equals 0. So this is this function in the simple case where lambda is very small. Now I evaluate the derivative and I end up with this very simple condition X bar is actually the short for the final composition when I just encapsulate one M. So this is going to set the border, and you can find that it is strictly positive. So this type of protocol does work to maintain functional objects in transient compartments. Now I'm just going to try to interpret it a bit more in terms of the error rate, like I have done at the beginning of the presentation. So the fact that this has to be larger than one, I take now the explicit expression that I had before, and I find this. So you see that now the difference, it looks like, now it starts to look like Eigen's formula. But S, now the selectivity is not just the ratio of the replicating strengths of the molecules, but is something related to the protocol. So this is where F matters, the values of F matter. It's how well a compartment that only has one ribosome to start is selected compared to the leakage of the protocol, so how much compartments completely invaded by parasites can still go through the selection. Well, note that if you have a perfect protocol, which cannot be the case, actually this would go to infinity. So it just says that if you can just always pick the object that works, it's very simple, it will always work. So if you compute it numerically, what you find, so this is log of lambda. Of course, you have this situation for a lot of lambdas as soon as they are smaller than one, so log of lambda smaller than zero. So you have kind of a plateau. Here you know that you go to zero. And you can demonstrate by the same type of calculation that this slope goes like 1/λ. And you have kind of a threshold here, which is determined by the other extreme situation where big lambda is very big and you have no mutations. But I don't have time to do it. So basically, this is a domain where your system can exist. So where you can have coexistence between ribozymes and parasites. And in this domain, you have an abiotic system. So just to reinterpret it in terms of error, it's not easy because you have this kind of convolved formula. This is the exponential of the factors alpha, lambda, gamma. This is a ratio, so you see there is no simple solution to this. But let's examine another particular case, which is when your parasite is approximately similar to your functional molecule. So the big difference with the Eigen problem is that now this can be actually larger than this, which is the molecular realism, if you talk about origins of life. So you obtain that lambda is approximately equal to this. So T, and actually, like before, you have mu, which is approximately equal to, if you put the microscopic description. Delta equals 1, because it's mu over mu in this case. And then you can introduce alpha T, which is the number of generations. And so you can take this formula, and then now, given those approximations, you obtain a new error threshold. Under transient compartmentalization. So the big difference is that now this is a property of the protocol and this is a property of the protocol. So this is how long you compete within the compartment, how many generations, and this is how good is the selection. Now you have the error rate and the length of the molecule. So, okay, I'm going to show you the experiment now. Is there something special to do with the... with what?
It's doing
this?
I think Matthew did it already.
Ah, okay. Thank you. Okay. Yes, indeed. So now, so it is similar to the Eigen model. It is an abstract model. Now, if you go to this level of realism, because in the end, that's the aim, to have replication, you need the two size, the two strands of the molecule, M. And so you should replace this M. You should add the explicit description of the plus and the minus strand. And then this condition would be replaced by the fact of having both actually in a compartment. Now there are, we are working on it, but there are the dynamics when you put this level of realism becomes different, because when you template an object by itself, you obtain an equation which is not first order, but is m equals something m squared. And you have like this hyperbolic growth, which diverges to infinity in finite time. So basically, it doesn't diverge because in the compartment you have a limited amount of food, but you have a slightly different regime also in terms of noise. So we are working on it. Yes. So this hyperbolic growth was found by the first experiment on self-replication, which were done by von Kidrowski, who used triplets of RNA, two triplets of RNA, which ligation is catalyzed by the examer and in a reciprocal way. Yes, so this is a general scheme, and each of these steps is very complicated, and it's very different types of group that work on it. But this is kind of how you could imagine the buildup of complexity in the origins of life. Chemists, prebiotic chemists, are trying to find ways by which you could synthesize the nucleotides. Then it's another problem. You have to imagine ways by which those nucleotides could assemble into heteropolymers, oligomers of certain lengths. And the idea is that those are more or less random. And then some of those, they would fold into catalytic molecules. So one limitation is that we don't really know what is the mapping between sequences, sequence space, and catalytic activities. And some of those would feedback in a way that they would help to assemble, for example, two oligomers to make another molecule, or at some point to make themselves. And there you have an autocatalytic system which begins to be similar to what we have described here. And at some point, you have this more fancy mechanism, which is template-based replication. So by analogy with life as we know it, template-based replication allows evolution because you have heredity, variation, and you must have a form of selection. When you have an autocatalytic set, a more primordial system where you don't have this copy of a sequence, it's not clear whether you can have evolution. So it has been demonstrated only in 2012 in a computational model. But this computational model shows that evolution is possible in this condition only when you have compartments. You need to have a level of selection of a collective to be able to have evolution. So compartments are very important because they would allow this, and as I have just shown, they would actually allow to have a template-based replication because we have seen it's necessary in any case. So there are people working on building a system that could do a template-based replication from RNA. And this is really an ongoing quest in the field of biochemistry. For the moment, there is no such object, and such object does not exist, or has not been found in nature so far. So the adventure starts in the 80s, where people take actually ribozymes from cells, and then they re-engineer them to do some steps of polymerization. And you also have the group of Jack Szostak, so they have been doing very ambitious experiments where they really select ribozymes from random pools. And from those objects, people are trying to continue to do directed evolution, so artificial evolution, to try to increase the processivity of the polymerase, so how long it catalyzes, and its fidelity, because we have seen it's a very important parameter. So this is now where we are somehow. You see the different molecules that have been engineered by biochemists. And the point is that now, in this article, they have a replicase which can copy a strand as long as itself, which is 202 or 6 nucleotides. The problem is that it cannot copy itself. It can only copy very specific sequences, which are repeats of 11 mers. The other interesting thing, if you look at the title, is In Ice, Evolution of RNA Polymerase. This was found because a student has analyzed a frozen sample that he was not supposed to have frozen. So a typical situation of science, like the antibiotics, you trash something, and you do something completely random, and you find the solution. Ice with salts forms the tectic phases where you still have some liquids confined and you have very high concentration there. It's very active, but the low temperature, so it works at minus 19 degrees. So you have a favorable balance between the competition of hydrolysis and catalysis by the object. So the work is, this group, so the group of Phil Holliger, is still working actually under this type of protocols. So just to show you some challenges, experimental challenges to make these objects, the idea is now to move, to fractionate, to make a self-replicating ensemble. So there is a convergence between the replicase scenario and the autocatalytic scenario currently. We are not fighting anymore, it's a good thing. So they do these freeze-thaw cycles, and they cut the object in small pieces so that the polymerase copies a small one, because it is able to copy a small one. And then at the same time, it copies something that allows to form a ligase, another catalyst that is going to assemble all these objects together. So the current status is that you can show that all these single steps are possible, but it's not possible to they don't work together, basically. None of them is efficient enough so that you have really a self-reproducing system. And it's quite far from this. The other interesting thing that I have put in the title, duplex stability, is that the big problem of replication in the details is that you need to separate the strands. And you, by definition, you have the strongest possible complementarity between the two long strands. So if you have smaller things, temperature cycling allows to separate them. So this is another advantage of fractionating the molecule. And there is another problem in biochemistry is that you have folded structures because those are catalysts. And so now the idea is not to use nucleotides, but triplets, for example. So it's an article that has just been published. And they have shown that triplets can invade secondary structures, so can start to open the folds, and you can start to replicate some small parts of this molecule. So you see, this project is on the way. Maybe one day we find such an object. Now, it seems that typically such an object would be quite long. It would be, yeah?
Just you were saying that it was not present in nature, that you were trying to build it. But you have some reasons why such an object that you see at the beginning of life would be erased, I mean, and not come again, and not, I mean.
Yes?
You were saying that it was stable, that it was specific, that it was, I mean, caused properties that could.
No, that's what you want from it, yeah.
So it means that
yeah.
It existed.
It was good.
In some way, it was good. So why simple?
Yeah, that's paradox number four. No, there is no convincing ideas on this. So okay, the only idea is that proteins, polymerases made of proteins, are so much better that they would have wiped out this type of objects. Now you see in current biology you have a lot of traces of catalytic RNAs, the ribosome, and well, something you could imagine if you think by continuity, you could imagine that you have first a ribosome protein world, or a ribozyme peptide world, where you have small peptides and rather small RNAs that cooperate, and you could form. You can, with the biology as we know it, try to make an organism working just on RNA and proteins without DNA. There are some labs actually trying to do this in Japan, so notably the former Yomo lab. You could imagine that you have a protein that replicates the RNA. The RNA then that codes for the protein, and another protein that, or the ribosome basically, which is a which is both RNA and protein, that makes the protein. It was not very clear, but you see what I mean. So, yeah.
The second question is that, mathematically speaking, are there people who are trying to address the question, what would be the probability that such a complex protein, because you're saying that you need some different complex protein, I mean, is it possible to have some idea about what is it?
Yeah, so okay. Yeah. So okay, my student Alex Blokhus, who has done all this work since last week, is trying to do this computation. I mean, no one is really trying to do it. Yeah, that's what I was going to say. The other problem is how could such a thing appear? And it's almost philosophers are working on this. I mean, this is the idea of gradualism. Can you have a gradual start of life, or is it really a big threshold? If you believe in the replicase only, it's a big threshold. Like 200 nucleotides, the size of the space is 10 to the 120. The number of atoms in the observable universe is 10 to the 80. There is a big problem. There is some redundancy in the space of sequences. So some people have computationally estimated what is this level of redundancy of secondary structures in the space of RNA. So already you reduce the size of the problem. But all those estimates are, no one really goes very far with them because they are not experimentally established, basically. And then you have, so this is the probability that a very complex molecule appears by itself. And the problem, as raised by Eric in the compartment, is the same in the bulk. You need to have the probability to find the 200 molecule with another complementary 200 molecule on Earth. I mean, in the book, The RNA World, which describes all these entire scenarios, they do the calculation that if you want to do this with only 40 nucleotide long RNAs, If that could work, you need the mass of Earth made of RNA to be able to start the system, which is not very realistic. Or then you believe that life has appeared with RNA on another supergiant planet. But don't laugh, because so yesterday I was we have this this working group in the University PSL. So who drives this type of research? Biochemist by curiosity, physicists start to do it. And the astronomers are really the one who animate the community. They need some marketing from us. You should not film this, actually. They ask us, I mean, what should we look at on planets? Because now they will start to do some spectroscopy on foreign planets to see life. I mean, yeah, I don't know. But yeah, you can ask this question in a great generality. Okay, so I will show you rapidly the experiments. I still have some time, actually. So what we did is actually a model, which an experimental model of the situation, which is not a replicase. Huh? So it's actually close to what the model is. It's a version 2 of the experiment of Spiegelman. So you have this protocell, which here is a droplet of water in oil. And in the middle of the protocell, you see RNA replicase. This cubital replicase is a protein that was found by Spiegelman, or studied by him, which is able to copy an RNA into another RNA. But it is a protein, so it's something that we put in the system, and it does not participate, it does not evolve itself. And so, to mimic this situation of a selective advantage, the RNA has two parts. One is the blue part, it's called the midi variant, is actually the part that is necessary to replicate the RNA. So Spiegelman, when he did the experiment in bulk, he found that you find parasites that cannot replicate others, but that can be replicated very well. And in the end, if you pursue this evolution, you end up with just this blue part, which is a minimal entity that can be replicated by the cubital replicase. So before there was a PCR technique, actually, people were using this system to replicate objects. RNA. And then this object is associated with a ribozyme, so it's a hybrid molecule. So it's an RNA which can cut another RNA here, and this RNA is made of a fluorophore quencher, and when you cut it, the quencher goes away and you see fluorescence. So it's kind of a model metabolic activity, and we select the system based on the ability of the system to do this. So you have here the two aspects. You have the ribozyme, which is able to copy. Which is a midi variant, actually. It's what allows the copy to happen. And you have the functional activity. Okay, it doesn't work. Okay, the protocol is what I have shown, so you can imagine a number of things. The good thing with the transient compartments is that they can be found in nature, so you could imagine about aerosol droplets. So you have all these theories about hydrothermal vents, where you have the generation of porous media. These ice phases, people think a lot about clusters on surfaces also. Lipid vesicles, so those are all classics. No one knows what happened. The latest scenario that is fashionable is dry-wet cycle. So you imagine this pond, and during the day it dries, and during the night it rains, and then maybe compartments are connected. Okay, and the experiment is putting the molecular system I have shown before, and you do the compartmentalization with microfluidics, So the typical scale of the channel here is 20 micron wide. We have 20 picoliter droplets. And here you see the aqueous phase, which is pinched by the oil and allows to make these very monodispersed droplets, which are compartments. And the selection is the operation that you see after. So here you measure the fluorescence due to the ribosome activity by the laser. You see the dot here, the bright dot. And then you have a feedback on the computer that activates an electric field so that the positive droplets are deviated on one side and the negative one are deviated on the other side. And then you pull the material. So you obtain these images, which is typically what you would obtain with a fax, for example. So each dot is a droplet, and you can have a reporter for the replication, so green fluorescence, so it's a DNA intercalant, and the orange fluorescence, which is the assay I have shown before. And you can imagine three types, you see actually three types of molecules. So you have empty compartments, where you see nothing from the start. You have active compartments, which both replicate and have a metabolic activity. And you have parasites, which replicate but don't have a metabolic activity. So you can, sorry, I prefer to show this. So you can run the experiment in different conditions to test your protocol. So first, you can do the same as the Spiegelman experiment, which is a bulk experiment. And what you see is very rapidly, the system completely collapses. Now, if you use compartments and without selection, it collapses, but it takes a longer time for a very simple reason, is that the parasites that appear, they just invade their compartment. They don't have the opportunity to invade the whole population at once. So it just takes a bit longer. And then you have the selection protocol where it should be completely straight. And can here you see that did not really happen as expected. But the postdoc has a position in Japan, a permanent position. He's still alive. Well, actually, so that push to investigate, and that's where we discover this idea of other types of parasites. So, so at this stage, there were different hypotheses. Why does it go down? And actually, if you take parasites that you find in the bulk experiment and you compete them with ribozymes that you find at the end of the experiment, you can purge the population. So there is a hidden parameter that we didn't control. All the point is that the protocol was run at constant total RNA mass. And as you had more and more parasites, the mass of the object was smaller and smaller. So you had more and more compartments encapsulated at the beginning of each round, which is this lambda parameter. Actually, lambda was increasing during the experiment. So if you rerun the experiment by controlling now the lambda, you can go up and save the postdoc. Yes. And so what you see is that basically it's a similar plot as this. It's just a different, slightly different parameterization. Big lambda is directly the mutant doubling time. So color-coded is a fraction of parasites. And so a red region is a very dangerous region where you have a lot of parasites. And you see appearing two zones in this diagram. So the aggressive parasites, which are the same as in the Spiegelman experiment. And you can show that those, basically, they appear spontaneously in each compartment. But generally, they invade the system and they are purged. So they do not transmit to another generation. And you have those soft parasites that... that was your question about evolution. So you really have a fraction of coexistence. And those objects, they are optimized, interestingly, they are optimized to survive with functional molecule when they have approximately the same replication rate, which sounds quite reasonable, actually. So you have useful and useless objects, but they all replicate. Evolution makes the sum replicate at the same rate. Another interesting fact is that if you look at the diversity, so going back again to evolution, you see, so this is bulk, and the x-axis is the point of deletion of the end of the molecule, and the y-axis, the deletion starts. You see that in bulk, you have very low diversity. Without selection, you have more, but it's still the same region of the plot. And then you have much more molecular diversity when you do this type of selection, transient compartmentalization selection. So if you measure the diversity, so you have different measures of ecological diversity, what you see is that in bulk, you have a slight bump. So it's when the parasite arrive and then they kill the system. In without selection, you rise much higher because you contain the system for some time and then it kills everything. But in the rounds we have run, in the selection experiment, you have a complete explosion of molecular diversity. So, I mean, you have a pretty simple protocol, transient compartment, and they provide you a number of things. They allow to maintain the functional molecules you want. They allow the coevolution of some other molecules. And they also select for objects that replicate at the same rates as others, which means that evolution makes that you don't need a fancy cell cycle control. You just end up with objects that are coordinated in the way they replicate. So it's a pretty simple protocol that is very rich in terms of all the molecular complexity you can get from it. So if I have, still have some time. So yeah, I will be done in five minutes. So just to show you, now we are not working anymore on template-based replication. Because actually, when you have the parasites in your lab, they contaminate everything and you have to move to another lab to continue to do experiments. So I prefer that other groups do this experiment. So this is what I was describing before template-based replication. You have potentially another type of system, which is you have a collective of molecules that help to make each other. And that idea was embodied by Stuart Kaufman in this article, where he was thinking about proteins, but it doesn't matter. It's any heteropolymers. And at that time, some people in mathematics, graph theory, had thought about this form of catalytic closure. So having a system which self-replicates is essentially about you take a random chemistry or random object, what is the probability that you find a cycle? Because this cycle could be autocatalytic. And you have it's like a percolation problem. So you have a pretty simple result that is the typical density of the number of edges divided by the number of nodes should be strictly larger than one, and then you have a finite probability to find such objects of actually any length. But if it's strictly smaller than one, then you can find in some instances of the system cycles, but the measure of all those realizations is zero compared to the rest. But then what Kaufman suggested is that take a typical prebiotic reaction, which is condensation, so you assemble oligomers, and fragmentation, and sometimes they cut. So in the center, the middle circle is monomers, and then the second circle is dimers, trimers, and you see that, of course, the combinatorial diversity increases exponentially. And there is an asymmetry in the number of ways you can obtain a certain molecule by condensation. So it's the one on the right, the top one where everyone goes. But to obtain a certain molecule by fragmentation, so this is condensation, sorry, by fragmentation, you have many, many ways. You have exponentially more ways to obtain the system by fragmentation. So from this, he said, okay, so I take the worst case in my space of random chemistries. I just look at this threshold, so number of edges divided by number of nodes, by considering the condensation model. And if you suppose that there is just a certain probability p that an object catalyzes another one, what you find is that this ratio, the density of edges, increases linearly with the size of the space. So you always get past the threshold for having a total catalytic cycle. So what this article said is that basically, in a random chemistry, it's very probable that you find autocatalytic systems. So, experimental realizations of it. So the first convincing one, so there have been works from von Kidrowski before. And then using really a ribozyme activity, it was this one from the Jerry Joyce group in 2009. Well, you have one object that can make itself from its reciprocal image. And now we are working with this one, which is a fancier version of this one. So it's a recombinase from a bacteria that has been reused to engineer a self-reproducing system. So basically, you see this object with four colors. You can cut it into parts. And then a covalent object is going to assemble the fragments together to make a new catalyst, which itself is going to be able to catalyze the formation of other catalysts from fragments. And you can program with this, so some of them you can make mutants, which will catalyze some other species and not some other. And so you can create a diversity of autocatalytic systems from those molecules. So you see, this is very recent, like 2012. This is the only experimental system by which you can build a diversity of autocatalytic sets. So what we are after is how could you start evolution there? I'm not going to show you how. I'm going to stop. But basically, the principles of Darwinian evolution are not bound to template-based replication. You could have a diversity of heritable states, which would correspond to different attractors in the space of reproducing system. You could have variation, you could have selection without having template-based replication. The most difficult concept is heredity. Heredity is very common in biology. We live with it. But in chemistry, it's very hard to imagine concretely how you could implement a system. You give the same food to everyone, but depending on your initial state, you go back to this initial state, and there are several such states. So no one knows how to do this for the moment. And just for the fun, so this is another experiment that we do. So you have the Formose reaction, which is one of the only few autocatalytic reactions we know. And here you have two populations which contain autocatalytic reactions. And half of the population has a very efficient autocatalytic reaction, and the other half doesn't. But they consume the same food, so they compete for a resource. And what is not trivial is that this competition at the level of chemistry is translating into a growth of the compartment. So efficient chemistries, they pump resources from others and they grow. And for example, you can play with this and put them through a porous medium, and then they will divide as a function of their size so that you double the efficient population compared to the inefficient population. So we expect that this could be a way, if you have a chemistry with heredity indeed, you could demonstrate a very rudimentary form of Darwinian evolution from a purely physico-chemical system. Thank you.